To hear the different reasons people are running, and God bless those ladies for remembering their friend in this way. When she wanted to run a marathon, they're out there on the course for her. That's going to be beautiful. We're checking in now with the professional men. What are you seeing, Ed? And I know you guys have been, we have four monitors here, so even when something else is on the air with you guys, they can watch the runners and keep up with the race. So what are you guys seeing so far?
Well, the men came through at 14:43 for 5K, which is about 2:04 marathon pace. I like the fact that we've got Kyohei Hosoya from Japan. He's a 2:06 guy, and he's feeling very comfortable. He's right up there. He's the guy in the red. He's got a 1:01 half marathon, so very solid credentials, but certainly running and surrounded by men who have run 2 to 3 minutes faster than him. But I like the fact that he's in the fight. They're running at a relatively conservative pace, since they were considering going out in 61:30 pace for a half, which would be more like 2:03. So they're about 2:04. Some of that might be just trying to hold back a little bit or battle the headwind that they're going against. Again, all the main players are right there together. But the guy in red is a Japanese runner, and he's they came through the fourth mile at 4:47. So again, right about 2:04 pace, which I think is probably for this talent level and for the number of guys that they have and the fact that they are bucking this headwind for the first 8 miles. That's a good pace.
All right, let's check in on the women's professional pack. And actually, it's not much of a pack. Isn't it Ruth basically by herself?
Yep, she's out. Let's talk about what she did in the first 5K. She went through in 15 flats. That's under 2:07 pace. So that means that she is flying right now. She's got her male pacers right there. Right behind her is Satume Kabete and Joycelyn Jepaskai. Only about 10 seconds back, so they are well under world record pace. The women went through mile four in 4:54 pace. That is under that 4:55 pace is what the world record pace is. So
okay.
Just flying, Marion.
Ruth, I feel like she has something to prove to herself, and she really wants to get out there and make it happen. I have
every
a feeling
year,
about her, right?
Every year she loves to come here and she gets out super hard. She puts her heart on the line. You know, winning here twice, getting second. She's got quite the record here.
She really does. She really does. We can't really discount that. She has an amazing record.
We do.
Two-time champion.
We do know a little bit about the Americans as well. Susanna Sullivan is the lead American. She went through the 5K in 16:27, so she's coming up to 4 miles now. But she's on 2:19 pace. So 2:18 is the American record. She's right there. Kira D'Amato and Betsy Sena in second and third.
All right, let's check in on the wheelchair races. I think we're going to start with the women's wheelchair. Catherine De Bruyne all by herself.
All by yourself. You know, I'm hesitant to say this because I don't think it could possibly be real, but I think
we're watching the men.
Yeah, I think John Carrier, again, who is one of our men who have run 2:05, is right there in things, and he's wearing the yellow. He's been a constant force right up behind the pace setter, so he must be feeling good. He's a two-time LA Marathon champion. He has done historically very well here at Chicago. He was third here in 2022. He was fourth in 2023. He knows how to get the job done here in Chicago, so I think that gives you an air of confidence here in the early miles. They're continuing to click along right at 4:47 pace, which again is going to be in the 2:04 range. And again, for today with the wind and with the quality men's field, I think that's a really good time. Not near as hasty and fast as the women are going right now, though, relatively speaking.
All right. Love to be able to check in on the women's moto, if at all possible, and see how Ruth Chepngetich is looking. Looks like they're making their way through Lincoln Park. Can we get to Dina? Dina, can you tell us anything? I don't know if we have Dina. Let's see if we have Gayle.
I hear you.
Oh,
it
okay,
is just,
go for it.
I mean, the Chicago voices are coming out on the streets. 1.5 million people are taking over your voice, Miriam. We just passed the 5 mile mark. And I know you're asking about the lead women, but we are also with the leaders of Team USA up here, Zach Panning and CJ Albertson, also projected to run 2:06. They are right next to me as as Ruth Chepngetich continues to just set a blistering pace. Sudeme Kabete is right off of her shoulders, but it's as if they're running two entirely different races, like they are just on a mission themselves, but there hasn't been any interaction between the two of them, which has been super interesting to see. They're just running their own races, and I think they're both hoping that as the miles wear on, that they're gonna be the one to sustain this blistering pace. Back to you guys.
All right, thanks so much, Dina Caster. We'll get to Galen Rupp out there following the men's professional field in just a moment. Here along Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, whatever you wanna do. All right, let's check in on the professional men's pack here. What are you seeing, Ed?
Well, I'm also liking what Mr. Amos Kipruto from Kenya is doing. He's the third, essentially in third place, fifth if you count the Pacers in there. He's in the solid blue with the yellow highlights. He is the man who's Mr. Consistency. He always finds a way to get on the winner's peristyle and at world. He's looking very comfortable. And they're getting the water bottles right now. It's always fun to see him grab it. Picked it up just a notch, and that's probably more in the wavelength they should be at for run 443s, which again is going to bring it down probably closer to 203 pace.
All right, let's check in on Ruth Chepngetich. She's looking pretty good still, Carrie.
She is, but right behind her is Sudeme Kabete. So there is, like Dina said, a two-woman race going on right now, two different races going on. But Ruth Chepngetich out very hard. She's right at 208 pace, right off the American men, which seems crazy, but that is typical for Ruth.
All right, sounds good. Let's check in with the second wave of runners as they approach. And apparently, excuse me, they're on a decent pace here, Ed?
Yeah, they are continuing to roll along at about 204 pace. One of our leaders is DeWitt Woldy. He's been wearing a white top with the blue. He's been consistently right in there. It's interesting because he was only 17th at Chicago in 2023. They have ratcheted down the pace a little bit, 441 for that seventh mile. And again, as they continue to do that, they will then go from 204 pace down to 203. I've been told that the Americans are back running right about a world championship qualifying time of about 206.30. They're headed by Zach Panning, CJ Albertson, and Brian Schrader are in a group together and looking good. It looks to me like they're trying to hit that 206.30, which is the world championship qualifying mark.
All right. Anything you want to add real quick, Carrie?
I just love that these athletes are working together. We talked to the American men before, and they want to start running that sub-207 mark. They have to in order to run at that international stage, and they're going for it together. It's really exciting.
It is exciting to see. All right, let's check in now with Stephen Holt. He's at the finish line with a special guest.
A special guest indeed, Marianne. Here, I'm here with Coach.
Right now. Trying to amend and the women's actually. We're going to take a look at Ruth Chepngetich, who is comfortably behind her own pacers. Those are her pacers, correct?
Those are her pacers, yes. And she is still hammering out 455 per mile. She's getting a little bit of distance on Sudeme Kabete. You know, one of the things that we've seen with Ruth is she's attacked this course so hard. In the past, when she's won, she has gone out in very fast over the half marathon distance and then crawled her way home and still been able to win. So it's interesting that she's still doing this. Yes, she's chasing that time, but she knows the win is more important than anything. So this is her style. This is what she does. You know, she is so good over that half marathon distance. She's a 64.01 gal. So she's got the leg speed. She's got the grit. She's self-coached. She trains with men. Huh? So this is comfortable for her to not have women around her. She doesn't like probably hearing. And, you know, men and women sound different when they're breathing at times. So she might not look, although she did just take a look back. So she's wondering what's going on in the race, but definitely hanging on to her paces.
All right, let's take a look at the men's pack. Is that Career toward the front?
Yeah, that's in the yellow is John Career. He's been there the entire way, just shaking out his arms, making sure he stays loose. But it's been Woldy, DeWitt Woldy from Ethiopia, who's been the guy that's kind of been content to ride right up behind in the slipstream of those pacers up front.
All right, let's check in with Galen. We were able to connect with Galen. Galen, what are you seeing from the runners right there at the front?
Yeah, one thing that I thought was interesting was Daniel Abeno missed his first bottle at the first water station, and he ended up stopping, going back and grabbing it. That is the only sign of distress I've seen on his face. Once he caught back up, he is back looking cool as a cucumber. Amos Kipruto, I think, is just running an unbelievable race right now. He is locked in, and just I really like where he's sitting in the middle of the pack. He is being shielded from the wind better than anybody, looks so relaxed. And John Carrera looks like he's just getting back on his shoulder too, but Everybody looks pretty comfortable here, I would say, all the main players.
All right, it's amazing that they are looking comfortable. What does that tell you, Ed?
Well, when you hear that Daniel Avenio missed a bottle, probably not a surprise. This is his first marathon. It is it's kind of a learning process, right? They're grabbing those bottles on the run. They're running at 4:40 pace, and it's tough to get that bottle off the table. The fact that he went and got it, I think he realizes that the need to have the fluids, and the fact that he was able to catch back up and ensconce himself very comfortably in that pack is a good sign for his day.
All right, don't go anywhere. We'll be back with more of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon right after this.
Chicago Marathon on NBC5 is brought to you by Abbott. Life to the fullest.
Field, it looks like at this moment,
sure
Carrie.
Does, sure
Ruth Chepin-Gettich is just with her pacers and a man off to the side that we can't see.
Yeah, she went through 15K in 45:32. That's 208:30 pace. Now, we have seen this world record come down time and time again in the last couple years. 211 is the world record right now by Assefa. Last year we saw Safwan Hassan chase this woman down to run the second fastest time we've ever seen in 213. So this is the thing, like Ruth Chepin-Gettich is such a go-getter and she's going for it. But we know this Tume Kabete is in second. Joycelyn Jepkoski is 2 minutes back. I don't know, I've starred Joycelyn's name. I don't know, but I just feel like maybe she is the one that's running within herself and running very smart. I mean, she's still on world record pace.
Okay.
So let's keep an eye on what Joycelyn Jepkoski is doing.
Yeah, it doesn't necessarily, just because they're not together right now,
yes,
we're still so early in the race.
So early, conserving energy, going out too hard can bite you in the end, right? So we know that Ruth is strong, but she has some very strong ladies behind her.
All right, it's always so fascinating, all the different tactics that come into play as it relates to marathon running. All right, let's check in with the men's elite again. And Ed, it looks like Career is still there. Walid is still there.
Yeah, that's actually Vincent Ngedich. Career is also in that pack. There's really about 10 men in that lead pack, but Woldi and Ngedich have been the two that have been right up there, right behind the Pacers. They're looking good. They came through 15K a while ago in 44:28, which again is about 204:28 pace. They're looking good. They just ran their 10th mile at 4:52. So, back and forth, I think the wind is buffeting them a little bit, but they're still staying consistent at about 204:28. Now, Vincent Ngedich, who's there in the yellow, just wiping his brow there, he is also really one of our pre-race favorites. He's only run two marathons, and in them, he got second at Berlin in 203. He was third at Tokyo in 204. Those both happened within the last year. So really, in terms of consistency and being a relatively newcomer, he's kind of a man to watch. So not a real surprise that Vincent Ngedich is there running side by side with DeWitt Woldi. But again, that pack, if they were to expand back, we really have 9 or 10 men in it right now. All of them are the guys that are the 205, 206 guys. Probably the biggest surprise up there right now would be Hosoya from Japan, who's a 206.30 guy, running with some guys that are a little bit faster than him. But hey, it's a good day out there, and who knows, maybe this is a day for a PR for him.
All right, now we're going to check in with the women's professional field of one at this moment, and Dina Kassler, who's right in front of her. Dina.
Best seat in Chicago today to watch this show unfold. If you see in front of you Satume Kabete's pack of about seven just attached themselves to Ruth Chepin-Gettich. So now we might see them working together as one system. It's been very separate from here on out. It looked like that gap was increasing, but in the last 5K, you saw that pack slowly reel in Ruth Chepin-Gettich. And now the game begins. Let's keep our eye on any dynamics if they come side by side to see if there's interaction between them. But in the history of distance running, it is always a Kenya-Ethiopia battle. And here again on the streets of Chicago, we're seeing that. Carrie Kapinkowski, the executive race director of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon, said yesterday in the press conference, people come here to run fast. I like to say it's the Kelvin Kiptum effect, but it's been happening for years. And this is the duo to fight to the finish to see this world record go down. 208 projected finish right now is still still smoking fast, 3 minutes under the current world record, almost 4 minutes. So they mean business today. There's still a lot of road ahead of them, but both women looking supremely good.
Dina, can you see any of the American runners earlier on? We know that they were right there with Ruth Chepngetich. Are you seeing any at this point?
Yeah, now the American men are further ahead. I think they're staying on that 206 projected finishing pace, while the women have slowed by a couple of minutes in their projected finish. But fast running all around, the weather out here is absolutely perfect for fast running. So whether we see world records, course records, American records, American Masters records, we're going to see thousands of personal bests today.
All right, thank you, Dina. Now let's check in with Galen Rupp, who's following the men's professional field. Galen, what are you observing?
I still think that Abeno looks phenomenal. He looks so relaxed. You can tell how comfortable he is running in the pack from all his track experience. And he is doing an exceptional job of just hanging back and biding his time for a first-time marathoner. And also,
there's Chris Foreman on the back of the
BSN. Also, Amos Kipruto, again, running a great race, staying super relaxed. He looks well within himself, and I think he's poised for a big finish. One thing I have seen is Wala Lang looks like he's been struggling a little bit. He's been wincing a lot, and he's run under 205. He's a 204.50 marathoner, but you can see it right now in his face. He will start to wince a little bit, and that usually could be a sign that he might be starting to break.
Thoughts on that, Ed?
Yeah, that's tough, and you know what? You have some very talented men. They're pushing the envelope in training, and sometimes the race starts rolling out, and you're only as good as your weakest link, and that may be what's going on with Lele right now. In terms of Benyo getting his water bottle on the last one, Galen, did he look okay on this last one? Is he getting a little more comfortable picking up the water bottle on the fly?
He looked better on the third stop. The second one, he was still a little shaky. He almost came to a dead stop getting it. But, it's always a bit of chaos at the water stations. He definitely cut a few athletes off right at the last second. So he's still getting used to it, but I think he's finding his way as the race is going on.
Yeah, well, and the good thing is the race continues on, that pack is going to get thinned out. It's one thing to have to wade through 10 people to get your water bottle, and then as you get down to 4, 3, 2, 1, then it becomes a lot easier. But really talented men in that field right now. So many opportunities. And Benya with that track speed, he's a five-time Kenya national champ at 5,000 meters. And so the man can run well under 13 minutes for 5K when you have that kind of speed, and then you're running only 4:45 miles, and it's a little more comfortable. They just told us, however, that the last men's mile was 4:36. Galen, could you feel the pickup of pace a little bit, and are things stretching out a little bit?
You could tell a few points it stretched out, but for the most part, everybody looks pretty comfortable. You know, that main group is really looks a lot really calm. DeWitt Wolde has always been up near the front, and I don't know whether that's a sign he's feeling really good, but sometimes it's a little early to be pushing this early, and when you're right up on the pacers, that's a lot of mental energy that you're wasting. But he looks great right now. He's tucked in right behind him, and the rest of the pack, they seem pretty comfortable too.
All right, now we're going to check in on the men's wheelchair. Thanks so much, Galen. I always love to hear your perspective. Just a few years ago, we were halfway point. What are you seeing here, Ed?
I still see Woldy up there working side by side with Ngetich, but Amos Kipruto now in the solid blue, asserting himself another a little bit now, moving up a little closer to that. But we still have really a pack of 8, 9 men running closely together, but Amos Kipruto now moving upwards a little bit now would be probably our third runner if you take out the pace setters. So this is a good pacing on their part. They came through 20K at 59.03, so that's 204.34 pace. And we should probably mention that the Americans, Zach Panning, CJ Alberson right now running together, they came through 20K at 1 hour even, which would put them on about 206.32 pace. I believe Shadrach Kipchirchir and Brian Schrader running together at 208.21 pace, so a couple minutes back. And now the men just came through half, 101.20. So they definitely have picked up coming through in 101.20. So now we're more at, you know, 202.40. My math skills are really good. I can double that. So 202.40 pace. So yeah, we see that they have stepped down. And again, we said they had that 4:36 mile in there. So things are really ratcheting up a little bit. And this is where things get exciting, because now from halfway on, we'll see if they, you know, have the temerity to try to negative split. Coming through in 101.20 though is a very solid pace.
Well, we were talking a lot about.
Sorry. I just was given it was actually 102.20, which makes more sense, because suddenly that's more like 404.40. So 204.40 pace is what we're on. They came through in 102.20 for half, and that's. Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
We talked so much about negative splits last year because that's exactly what Kelvin Kiptum was doing. So it's exciting when you start to hear that discussion, but that's not happening at this point yet, right, guys? All right, we want to take a look now at Ruth Chepin-Gedich. She is still coming. She's moving her way to the halfway point, still looking like she is by herself. Carrie, what are you hearing and seeing?
We have heard that she's about 8 seconds up on Sutume Kebede, and they're coming up to that half marathon, which is going to be super fast. We know in 2021, she went out in 67.34, and that's when she came back and ran 7.74 for the second half, but still won. So she is well under that this year, and she is chasing that record. We know that. That world record of 2:11.53 set in Berlin of 2023 by Tagist Assefa.
Assefa, yeah, let's see if she does it. I know I feel like sometimes that she's felt like she's had a little, not a chip on her shoulder, but to have Stefan Hassan come in here and really kind of dominate last year, do you think she feels like she has something to prove?
I think she didn't like finishing second. She wants to be one of those very few that have won three times, but she is somebody that is thinking now about the time. I mean, so many people are talking about, can women break 2:10? Well, she is on pace for that. She just went through half marathon in 104.16.
Wow.
That's one of the fastest half marathons we've ever seen.
Oh, wow.
So
wow.
She's going through now in her halfway split in that. And so she is someone that has sort of changed the sport. She was one of the first people, if not the first, I think, to break 65 minutes in the half marathon. She's just always someone that takes charge and goes for it.
All right, good for her. And does it quietly and slowly and just in her own way. All right, let's see if we can take a look at the men's wheelchair. Another little lead shift here, Amanda, but this is tactical. This all feels tactical. With those folks. Ed, what do you see?
Yeah, well, we've got nine still in that lead, and Woldy now has moved back up. He's been content to be that second guy along with Ngedich, and Ngedich in the yellow and Woldy in the blue, and that's Kenya versus Ethiopia. And these two East African countries, they are the medal winners in international championships and competitions. And there is a friendly rivalry, maybe sometimes not so friendly rivalry between these two countries. And so certainly there is pride amongst them in trying to beat one another in the field. But right now it's Ngedich strongly in leading. They came through the 14th mile in 4:44. So they really continue to kind of roll off mile splits that will bring them home in about 204. And I think that is why we're still seeing about eight men besides those pacers in that lead pack. So really, you can't discount anybody that's in that lead pack. And when you have synergy like this running together past half marathon, then you know you're probably going to have a blazing finish. And Amos Kipruto in the solid blue there on the right of the screen right now in the Adidas kit. He's also from Kenya. He has the second fastest personal best at 2:03.13, and he knows how to win and place well in big time marathons. He was a bronze medalist at the World Championships in 2019. So I think he's feeling pretty good. But right now, anytime the pace lags, Vincent Ngedich is the man there. He's 2 for 2 in terms of marathons. He's run 2:03.13 and 2:04.18 recently, and that's right around the pace they're at right now.
All right, let's check in with the women's elite one person in there with her pacers. And Carrie, the halves have been showing some impressive times.
Oh my goodness, we have seen the two fastest women ever over half marathon on U.S. soil. This is so exciting. Ruth unofficially is the U.S. fastest half ever, and she's on the fifth fastest in history.
Wow.
I mean, she's running so well, but we have a long time to go. And Sutume Kebede, she's only about 15 seconds back.
Wow.
So she's not out of it.
Not out of it, no.
And at paces like this sometimes, they can be self-destructive paces when they're going that hard.
Yeah, yeah.
So the fact that that's the fastest half marathon ever run on American soil, and she still has another half to go, tells you.
Is that career still?
Yeah, I think that's career. Again, our two-time LA marathon champ who has done so very well here at Chicago, getting third here in 2022, fourth last year. He has been a guy that's kind of followed the pace. And when you see the pack stringing out like that, then you know some work is being done. Right now, I think it's Carrere, Ebenyo, Kipruto, and then four or five others that are just chasing that pack, looking very solid. And again, just trying to match things. They ran 4:43 on the last mile. They continue to hover right around. They ran 25K through 1:13:47, so they're about 2:04:32 shape pace. And this is where things get difficult. Amos Kipruto back a little bit from Carrere. There's a little bit of an opening. I think it's still probably too early for him to break them. But behind Carrere, our next man is Kipruto wearing the solid blue.
All right. Right now, the men's elite group is on Jackson in the West Loop. They just passed the target, didn't make any stops. It's tough not to pass the target and not go in, but they did not. They are just at the Aberdeen area, so they're making their way around mile 16. She's led the entire way, really, Carrie.
She has. She is about 50 seconds up from Satume Kabete. So Satume falling off just a little bit. We know that Joycelyn Jepkoski is 4 minutes back in third place. So Ruth is really hammering. But let's just give a little bit of an update on the American women. We know our first American is Susanna Sullivan, the teacher from D.C. We love her story.
Love it.
She has done so well in the last couple years. She hasn't gotten quite the attention, which she should. She was 58th at the World Champs in 2023 on a broken patella. That's your knee.
Ooh.
And you think of running. You use your knee every single time you take a step. So she really had to work through that. She missed the Olympic trials this past February, and so having a really great race right on 2:20 pace, which would be a huge PR and well under that world championship standard, which a lot of the Americans are going after, which is 2:23:30. And then in second and third for the Americans, Betsy Sena and Emma Bates. So Betsy Sena, the fastest American in 2024, trains with Joycelyn Jepkoski, has also been coming back from an injury, and so has Emma Bates. Emma Bates ruptured her plantar fasciitis last year in this race, still finished, but is so strong and is saying she thinks she's in shape to run under 2:20, but is trying really just to have fun. I got to tell you something fun about her. She has these awesome nails right now, and they look like claws. She says the claws are coming out.
All right.
Yeah.
Whatever it takes to get you motivated, to get you moving. All right, let's check in with the men.
Well, and unfortunately, I was going to add, we have not had a split off of Kira D'Amato since 15K, which is not a good sign. We were speaking just 2 days ago, and unfortunately, in the taper, her foot, she's got a little tiny pain in the arch of her foot. Sometimes in the marathon, you are only as good as your weakest link, and I'm afraid that maybe some plantar issues have flared up, but that was so rare. We were patting ourselves on the back last week because we had got through the build with out an injury, but sometimes in that pre-race taper, as you bring the mileage down, then you'll have little things that come up. So unfortunately, I think she's out.
It's part of the game, right? Yeah. I mean, as unfortunate as it is, that's what happens when you're a runner.
Yes, absolutely.
And looking at the men now, we got two men in yellow. The one with arm sleeves, that is John Carrere. Again, he's been third here. He's been fourth here. He's been the guy that's been following the paces. They ran their last mile 17 at 4:40, so that's a good solid pace. And running right comfortably next to him is his Kenyan countryman Vincent Ngedich in the yellow, also looking very good. Our lead pack down now is down to seven men. Let's see, Ebenyo, who is the newcomer, he's kind of back there, the taller runner as well. He's looking very comfortable. He has not yet took a sniff into the lead because he knows this is his first one. He wants to just follow for as long as he can and maybe use that track speed at the end. And then Amos Kipruto in the solid blue, in the darker blue. He's the consistent man, and he was also one that also has the second fastest personal best time of 2:03:13. So he's feeling pretty comfortable right now as well.
All right, let's check. We are going to check in with the men's elite group. What are you seeing here, Ed?
Well, continuing to see package seven men now running, and they're up and challenging the pace setter. And it looks like we've got somebody who wants to take the lead over the pace setter. The pace setter's done an admirable job. He's kept them at 204 pace, and right now we've got a new leader moving into the lead. The reason why we saw him spreading out right there, they're going for their water bottles. And it's amazing, and that's it. Issa, for the first time, we're seeing him take the lead. And part of that was just at 30K here as they get their water bottles. He was moving forward. He was accelerating so he could get access to his bottle. But sometimes that also tells you how they're feeling, the fact that they can accelerate, they can pick up their bottle running fast. And now, but I think he's also now tucked himself back in now that he's coming.
He is a big name, yeah, though, Mohammed Issa.
And we have not even talked about him so far.
Second in the Boston Marathon this last spring. I mean, he's just kind of sitting on the heels of all these athletes, maybe just waiting for the right moment. But he is a huge name, and it was kind of fun to just see him up there because it is such a big pack. It's so different than the women's race.
So often it's the guys you don't talk about for the first three-fourths of the marathon that end up coming on strong at the end, and the fact that he could accelerate, grab his bottle like that, and then ensconce himself back in the pack is a good sign for ASA fans.
What are they grabbing when they grab their water bottle? I'm always fascinated by their nutrition. What's going into what they're taking in?
Well, it's just a carbohydrate electrolyte mix. It's usually about 6% carbohydrate solution. Back in the old days, we would just use D-Fizz Coca-Cola, which was about 6% carbohydrate. Now they're a little bit more high-tech. We have potassium, magnesium, all kinds of electrolytes in there to help boost them through. Some of them just take water, and then they'll take a gel that will have a more concentrated kind of glycogen mixture in there that they'll take on. But everybody has their own water bottles that they're comfortable with, that they have their elite fluids in.
All right. They are making their way. I'm not exactly sure. And we just lost some pictures. So let's check in on Ruth Chepngetich. She is still all by herself and apparently on a pretty good pace here, Carrie.
Yeah, I mean, it's no surprise to see her by herself, but I do think it's just so interesting how much she relies on those pacers, as we can see her going, just even grabbing normal water, not quite able to catch it, which I don't love because that does show your coordination and maybe your focus. She got it, right? But it took her three times. She is really moving fast, though, to try to grab those waters. But yes, she is all on her own. And as I said, she is one that trains by herself. She just went through mile 18. That's right around 30K at 4:59. So she's just been hitting 4:59, 4:58, 4:59. She is still under world record pace.
Wow. I want to ask you some more questions about her training for herself. But first, we want to go to the finish line and Alex Maragos, who is with our men's champion. Impressive. All right, we're back to Ruth Chepngetich. Question about her training herself. Carrie, what does that tell you? How in the world do you do that? I think that would be so difficult to do.
Yeah, I mean, she's been doing it for quite some time, and, you know, she has these male pace setters, so she writes her own plan. She runs about 105, 110 miles a week on 6 days a week, so she takes Sundays off. She's a mom, like, she's a businesswoman. She has all these goals in mind, and she just gets it done. There are more athletes now, and Ed can speak on this. Yes, there are a lot of women and men that have coaches, but there's also a lot of people that take what they've learned, and they've made their own plans, and they've done really well with it.
What do you think about that, Ed?
Yeah, no, I think, you know, I was, as an athlete, I was self-coached for about three-fourths of my career as well. You tend to pick up things along the, and if you're doing this for 10, 15 years, then you kind of see what other elites are doing, and you kind of incorporate that. I always liked, though, thinking back on my career, the times when I did have a coach or at least a close training companion that I could bounce ideas off of and make sure that I wasn't either overdoing it, underdoing it, and that I was pacing my, doing my pre-race strategy correctly.
Yeah, that makes sense. Just to have someone that's kind of an outside eye checking you out from an objective point of view versus you trying to make sure you're on track. Okay, Ruth is 1 minute and 57. 7 seconds ahead of her next competitor, Satume Kebede. So it's her race right now.
Yeah, but 30K, so they still have about 12K to go.
So they got a ways to go, but still, we'll see. She's been pretty consistent. All right, who are we looking at now? Let's take a look at the men. The Pacers look like they've fallen.
Yeah, this is a big point because the Pacers are now there, and now the real racing begins. And with the real racing, we have Career looking good. John Career, again, he has run so well here at Chicago in the past, getting third here, getting fourth here. And then the man who is right on his heels, Amos Kipruto in the dark blue, Mr. Consistency, always runs well, always finds a way to get on the podium at these World Marathon Majors. And I believe that's Asa in third place, also with the arm sleeves, looking very good at this point in time. We haven't talked a lot about Asa, but he was the one at the last water stop that moved out. What has he done? Well, he was only second at the Boston Marathon in 2024. He's run 2:06.58. And the last mile 20, they ran in 4:37. So the reason why we're seeing a disintegration of this pack a little bit is they are picking up the pace, running a 4:37 for mile 20.
I like how you said the race is now really on. This is always when it gets extremely exciting, and when I guess the tactics. This is a different level of tactical race at this point.
Yeah,
Ed?
Yeah. I mean, I often say, you know, you can divide the marathon into two equal halves: the first 20 miles and the last six, because everything is kind of preamble to the real racing. That last final 10K, where the gloves come off and they really can start duking it out. Now the paces are out of the way, and we're seeing who is it that wants to keep the pace going. And right now, the man who wants to keep that pace rolling along is John Career.
Real quick, I want to send a shout out. We have some folks behind the scenes that are giving us a lot of the times and making sure we know the splits and things like that. Dorian Kale from the New York Marathon always focuses us really well in the wheelchair. Jay Holder, who I call the encyclopedia of running, bringing up all the times and keeping track of everybody. And Mary Kate Shea from the Boston Marathon. They always provide such tremendous support. The more eyes, the better, as we can see. Ed is making motions with his hands. I'm trying to interpret that.
That means that John Career is putting some pace in. And we know they ran the last mile in 4:36. That's stretched it out. My guess would be that if we look at this next mile, that is another fast one, because suddenly it's gone from a pack of seven people to a pack of one with some chasers behind him. So I'm glad we were able to catch this. And it looks like the guy who's leading the chase pack now is Amos Kipruto.
I like, though, John Career this year. He's been winning his races. He came in this year with his tune-ups. We call them tune-ups, their final races. He ran Falmouth in August. He won there. He was first in the Utica 15K, but last year he was second in both of those races. So when you've been fourth and third here, you got a chip on your shoulder. You want to break that tape, and he seems like the guy that really is going for it, obviously breaking this open.
Yeah, and he put a little distance there, that's for sure.
He has. And when you're in that chase pack, you haven't given up at this point in time. For one, you're wanting to beat those guys that are right around you, and you know that things happen over the last 5 or 6 miles in the marathon. So if you can hang tight, sometimes you can weather the storm and come storming back if John Career gets a hiccup here.
Do you like when the athletes take off at this moment? I mean, so there's still time to be run, so it's nerve-wracking for me. If he's feeling good, go for it. Or do you say sit?
You know, 6 miles
relax.
Is still long way to go,
yeah.
Isn't it? And there's so much. And this is about the time. You talk about the wall that's in the marathon. Well, obviously, these guys train so that they can bust through that wall. But there is a point where you start exhausting the glycogen that's in your muscles, the glycogen, the energy that's used to do muscle contractions and to move fast at the end of the race. And right now, he is burning some glycogen, but he is opening up some time. It would be nice if we can get to Galen and talk to him and see what's
You're right.
Going
Let's
on
see
there.
If we can hook up with Galen and see what he's observing about John Career. We're going to do that right after we hit a break and try to check in and see right who the person who is closest to him. He's on the camera that is following John Career. We'll get back to Galen Rupp in just a moment so he can give us his rundown of what he thinks John Career is doing right now. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back with more with our reporters that are out on the course. We'll see what's going on. We're going to start in just a few minutes with Matt Rodriguez and Courtney Hall. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with the 46th running of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon.
We're here at the halfway point cheering.
Understand, it's a well-deserved rest. She has been amazing this season. Now we're going to check in on our leading woman, throughout the entire race and continues. Ruth Chepin-Gedich, and still looking pretty strong, huh, Carrie?
She looks really strong. She had a couple slower miles, but slower in terms of just what her pace is, 507, 502. This woman is on pace to do something that I never really thought I would see in a lifetime until we saw last fall in Berlin when Tagisa Seffa ran 211. She is well under 210 pace, people.
Wow.
She's on 209.09. We want to cheer her on so much to see something that is, it's almost like seeing someone land on the moon. Remember way back in the day, I had a friend just say that to me. He said, it's like landing on the moon. This is something we've never seen.
That's how I felt last year when we saw Kelvin Kiptum with all those negative splits and come in almost under two. It's one of those, you're right. This is remarkable athleticism.
To break 210 would be equivalent to breaking 2 hours, maybe even better than that. For a woman to break 210 would be like a man breaking 2 hours. So this is historic stuff that we're watching right
now. 211.53 is that world record. The next one is the course record here, 213.44 by Safwan Hassan, the woman that won gold in Paris. So yes, what Ruth Chepin-Gedich is doing right now is crazy. I mean, that's really the only word that comes to mind right now. It's, we've seen her run this hard before, but look at here. I like that she's able to grab her water. I know it seems silly, right? But to be able to go over, get the right bottle, be able to grab the water, whatever it is, she still has her wits with her, right? Like when you get this far into the race, sometimes you get foggy. Sometimes you get a little bit where you don't really know what's happening. She looks like she is well aware of what's happening around her. She is in Chinatown. It's loud there, and she knows she's getting close to home.
That, you know, and hopefully that'll help give her a little bit of spirit. You know, when you hear those crowds
for
as you come through, hopefully it'll help her out. All right, now we're losing a little bit of our signal, but this is I think our men's leader right here, Ed. This is Zach Panning.
Zach Panning, he's the American leader. He's on 207.14 pace. He came through 35K at 145.32, which puts him at 107.14. So he is slowing a little bit, but he's still getting his form together. This would be a big PR for him. He's running, his PR is at 209.28, so he's a couple of minutes ahead of that. But he's got some hard running ahead. And then on the split screen above, you can see John Carrere, who is our leader, who's just blown away that chase pack. That group of maybe seven runners that were together. The reason why, his 22nd mile was run at 4:22. Zach Panning is ninth place, I've just been told, on 207.14 pace. And up front, we got John Carrere still holding it together, ran a 4:22 22nd mile.
Thank you so much, Carrie, for some of that insight as to where your brain is as you're making your way. So the fact that Ruth Chepin-Gedich is able to do what she does is that's the kind of background information that we don't know when you don't run that helps us understand what they're going through. And it is good to see. Here she is. Here's Ruth Chepin-Gedich. It's great to see the American doing pretty well. Ninth place is nothing to sneeze at in this race, right?
Well, and he's on a pace that would put him a minute ahead of his PR. And 207, he'd be very happy with that.
We know that the American women, Susanna Sullivan, is still in the lead there, and she is still on that fast pace of 220. So giving a shout out to her, having a great day.
All right, we're going to try to get back and get a look at Susanna in the women's race as well. Right now, though, we want to check in with Stefan.
Makes it even more exciting.
Special moment.
Yes.
What was that like to have Joan Bonnet Samuelson coming down to congratulate you?
It was like something out of a dream. Like, I still look back on those pictures, and I get like just like butterflies. And that happened years ago, but it's so special, and just seeing these women, how supportive they are and how incredible they are to the next generation. Like, I just hope I can be even like a percentage of that to the next generation as well and show that going forward, because it's been incredible to receive that.
You both have done so much for the sport, but you've also done so much here in Chicago. We talk about it being flat and fast, of course, but there's got to be something else. What is another factor about Chicago that really lends this to being such a great competition?
I think it's the carry factor. Carrie surrounds himself by a really great team. And what's so great about Chicago is it's a marathon for runners by runners. They really understand the runners' needs and their psyches, and it just makes for a really great event. It's October, it's Chicago.
Are we going to see you back here in Chicago soon?
Oh, yeah.
All right, Emily, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Well, send things back to Alex Maragos. Alex.
Hey, Stefan, thanks so much. Here at Daniel Roman Trek, our second
American women, the leader for American women. This is Susanna Sullivan. Very exciting for her.
It is, and I think everybody loves her story. She's a teacher. She's a volunteer coach at George Mason. She works really hard, trains really early, trains late at night. but she's in eighth place right now. I'm seeing a little bit of discomfort right now, but she's on 220 pace. That would be a 4-minute PR. So, like, just get through, right? Just get through. She is a minute and 9 seconds up over Emma Bates. And Emma Bates has had quite the history here, too. She's run really well. She was second in 21, but last year came here, still was one of our top Americans, and ran on a plantar fasciitis or plantar that tore. And it took her out of the Olympic trials, along with this woman, Emma Bates, Susanna Scaroni, two of our best here in America.
Sullivan.
Back to
Scaroni is our wheelchair.
Sullivan, two of our best back here with a little bit of revenge. Their bodies are working today. They want to take advantage of it.
All right, love seeing it. And as we can see up in the corner, Ruth Chepngetich still doing well. She is in mile 23 at 501. What does that tell you?
That's a good sign. That's a good sign because she had some 507s, 506s. Now she ran a 501. So I think that gives you some adrenaline to know that she has not fallen back that far. I think we could possibly see a sub 210, which would just be amazing. Otherworldly.
Well, you know, when we saw Kelvin Kiptum run last year, it was a moment that all of us were like, pinch me, right?
Right?
So 200. That's what we saw last year. And then the heartbreak that we've all kind of faced over the last year without him. And all of these athletes are running with him on their mind. And
they
know that Ruth Chepngetich thinks about him probably every day when she's back home. So she's running that way. She is running with a chip on her shoulder and with an angel up above.
You got that right. We said that he was inspiring this race, and I really think he is. I think people are gaining strength from him because watching that performance from him last year was mind-blowing. It was really something to see. All right, we've got Ruth Chepngetich, as we said, and I think we are going to try to check in. Is it possible to check in with Dina? In the meantime, let's see how we're doing with the men's elite field. We've got John Carreer still out front.
John Carreer, this is the loneliness of the long distance runner that you like. He's got a 30-second lead over the chase pack. His miles, his last few miles have been 422, 431. He just ran a 446 for mile 24, so he's slowed a little bit, but having said that, he still has opened up a 30-second gap. And sometimes you don't want to look behind you in a race, but sometimes you sneak a quick peek and you realize, man, I don't need to keep rolling out 430s here. I can just roll in with 440 pace and still come home the champion. But he's still got a couple miles to go, and he's moving well. Form looks okay to me, and if you look in the back shot in the background, we're not seeing that chase pack right now, so they're back.
They are. They are not close to him. I mean, like you said, it looks like a lonely race right here. Do you want to be here? Would you rather have people around?
No. I want to be in the lead with
by myself.
I love that he did this. He's run his best times this year. He's set two PRs in the half and the full this year. He is gutsy, and he's taking advantage of what we all want to do. We want to take advantage of our best years of our life. He's having the best year of his life, so why not go for it?
Go for it.
And his brother, we know that his brother, Wesley Carreer, is such an amazing runner. He is a winner in himself. So he has a little bit of like a tool in his back pocket, having his brother say, go for it. You can do this.
Yeah.
It's your turn.
Yeah, why not? Galen Rupp is on the moto right in front of John Carreer. What are you seeing? How does he look to you, Galen?
He looks phenomenal. I mean, there is still so much bounce in his stride. His eyes are looking around, moving. He's looking at people as he crosses by, and he looks very comfortable and in control. He is really just running a fantastic race right now, and I think obviously he's got a big lead. I think there's a great chance this is going to be your winner right here. He looks amazing.
Galen, you've been in this position before. You won the 2017 Bank of America Chicago Marathon. What do you think he's thinking right now?
I think he can smell it, and I think he can sense it a little bit. You know, he's not far from the finish line, and the crowds are getting bigger. His stride and his cadence still looks very similar to where it was a couple of miles ago, and he's not looking back anymore. When he first started to make the break, he was checking to see where his competitors were, but for the last few kilometers, he is just in the zone, and he's just driving towards the finish line right now.
Can you see who's battling for second? We've been told Essa and Mbeno is still back a good 30 seconds. You may not even be able to see them.
I'm sorry, can you say that again?
I say, can you see who's next coming down on him? We hear Essa and Mbeno are back, but they're a good 30 seconds back.
Yeah, I'm having a hard time seeing the chase pack right here from where I'm at. And I'm running riding next to Carreer. I'm not running in the lead moto, but yeah, he is looking great. He's continuing to keep the pressure on, and I think right now it's just a matter of managing his energy to the finish line, but he can certainly sense that he's close and he knows the victory is within his reach.
Galen, I have a question for you. You know, Chicago comes out for this marathon. Chicago gets excited. The people come to cheer folks on. What does that mean as you're making your way toward the finish line to have those crowds cheering you on like that?
Yeah, the fan support is amazing. I'm having a hard time hearing you with all the crowd support that is out here right now. And the closer you get to the finish line, they just get louder and louder. And it certainly helps take your mind off of any pain you're in, any discomfort. Everybody's tired at the end of the marathon. But when you start hearing those cheers and they get louder and louder, that energy is just palpable. And it can really carry you to the finish line.
I can't even imagine the pain that you must be feeling. There's your leaderboard. We see John Carreer at the top. Amos Caputo behind him by a minute 32, but he's neck and neck with Issa. He's right there with him.
Ed. Wow. What he has done over this last 10K is amazing. Think about it. They had seven people running together just 4 miles ago, and the fact that he threw in that 422, 430, 430, exploded that pack. Now they're a minute and a half behind him. They're going to be battling. Well, it'll be an interesting sprint finish, but we're not even going to see them for a while.
Yeah, we'll miss the sprint for second, but but first he seems to be solidly all by himself and not hurting
a bit. Well, and he's not hurting it a bit because he just ran a 4:25 for his 25th mile, 4:25. So he's well in sight here with a couple of turns of the finish line, and no one's catching him at this point.
No, he is along Michigan Avenue right now, South Michigan Avenue. He's making his way toward Roosevelt and Mount Roosevelt, which we all know is a painful little last push in that point two. But he's got such a lead with a minute 32. I mean, unless he started walking, I think there's no way he's not going to get this one.
Well, I love seeing this right now. Ruth Chepngetich almost up on the heels of her pacers. This is hard work for her pacers to run this pace. Not a lot of men are doing it today. Mm-hmm. She's right up there with our top men. So for her to be kind of chomping at the bit, she still has 2 miles to go. We know that she had one of her slowest miles just in that 24th mile, 5:24. So we need her to stay on it right now.
All right, we got to get back to John Carreer. He is now on Mount Roosevelt. He's about to make that turn onto Columbus Drive. He is about to become the 2024 Bank of America Marathon Champion.
He's past the 26-mile mark. This is the last little rise here, but his stride will not be checked. He's powering up over that last little hill. He goes over this bridge. He's going to make a left turn, and then it's just a sprint finish to the finish of this marathon. But quite frankly, he's been sprinting from mile 20 on. He has taken a pack, a very competitive pack of 7-8 runners, and he has completely blown them away. They're minute and a half behind. He's now seeing the finish line. And John Carreer, what an inspiring race. John going to his arms, looking good. A little bit of grit, of determination on his team, on his teeth. He will be the 2024 Bank of America Chicago Marathon champion. And what a way to do it. Strong last 10K, all the way to the finish. Props to Mr. John Carreer from Kenya. Unofficially, the time, 2:02:42 unofficially. What a great finish, great negative split. We'll have to check on that negative split for you, but he definitely came home faster in about 60 minutes plus, and most of that was done over the last 10K.
That's given him a personal best, doesn't it?
Yes.
I mean, that takes him a couple, is that full minutes? Or
that puts him, coming into this race, he had run, 2:05:01. He ends up 2:02, second fastest in the race history behind our winner from last year, Kelvin Kiptum.
Wow, amazing. Congratulations to John Carreer, your 2024 Bank of America Marathon Champion. It is always so inspiring to see these athletes at work. That they're still walking around at the end of 26.2 miles is remarkable. There's Kerry Pinkowski shaking his hand. What a beautiful thing to see. Congratulations to John Carreer. Take in this moment. Is this his, I know, has he won others? I believe this might be one of his biggest,
He's won the LA Marathon twice, so there were some good signs on that. He ran 58 minutes for a half marathon recently, which is also a great sign. And now we're seeing, if we look at the screen now, we
looking
see
at the
Zach Panning, who's our top man right now. Again, Zach, kind of a heartbreaking story. He led the Olympic trials for 18 miles, did a lot of work there, and then faded. Looked like he might finish third, but faded to sixth place. But he's still running hard. He's running with the Japanese runner that we saw earlier on. Hosoya is right with him. And now he's just wanted to finish the best he can.
All right. We also want to check in with Ruth Chepngetich because she seems to still be on fire. Great to see Zach panning there, but here's Ruth Chepngetich still by herself.
Woo!
Just did her 25th mile in 4 minutes and 45 seconds.
Yes, she is going for it, and that's what I said right when we were going away. I'm like, she's got to get back on it. She is. We are on world record pace. We know that, but this could be a sub 2:10 marathon. It is crazy. She is losing her pacers as we said. She is now on Michigan, and she knows she can feel that finish line. She's already
been. Does she know the timing at this point? Does she time herself?
Yes, for sure. She has people. Well, she doesn't have a watch on her, but she can see the lead vehicle.
Okay.
And it does give you your pace, your projected pace. So she's watching that.
Wow. She must be. Well, she has had a goal. I feel like she's one of those people who has always been quietly, if she's even slightly in the back, she's in the lead, but she's always in the mix. So, and I know last year she was not happy being second.
She was not happy with second. She has a bubble around her when she races. She is all eyes on her pacers, all eyes on the front, and she trains alone, and that's something when you train alone, you coach yourself, you have to have such a strong mind. And she has visualization that she works through. She knows the different models that she has to have, and she is doing it, everybody. She is right there hanging on, and this is where it's loud on the course.
Oh yeah, which should help her. I hope they're giving her a lot of energy and a lot of strength, boosting her along. I love how the city of Chicago comes out, makes itself known, shows us out proud, even when it's raining and not so great outside.
One of my favorite stories about Ruth Chepngetich, her dad wanted her to go to secondary school, and she said, no, I want to be a cop. And then she started running, and she said, no, I want to be a runner. And then he was okay with her being a runner because she's winning. And now I'm sure he is thinking, doing something that she's never done and nobody has ever done on this planet.
Amazing. All right, now we're going to take a look at the new U.S. men's leader. We've had a switch. C.J. Anderson has now taken the lead.
C.J. Albertson.
Albertson, I'm sorry.
He did the same things.
Albertson.
He's the U.S. 50K record holder. He did the same thing with Zach at the Olympic Trials Marathon, where Zach Panning led for a lot, and then C.J. Albertson came up strong at the end to overtake him. He's done the same thing. He will be, looks like our top American now, has moved in. He's on 2:08:14 pace, so the pace has lagged a little bit. They're not going to get that world championship qualifying mark, but 2:08:14 for him is still going to be a very good day. His PR is 2:09:53, so if he can hold it together, this will be a nice PR for him
as well. He's going to the top of Mount Roosevelt, and he over the bridge. He'll soon be ready to turn onto Columbus Drive. He'll be able to see the finish line in his line of sight.
He's a father of two. I love how he trains. He puts bricks under his treadmill. He puts these sauna type lights in his room that he trains with. He's on the treadmill year round. He does different things, and he's going for it. He's having a phenomenal day.
Sauna lights on the treadmill?
Yep, he wants to sweat it out, learn how to just grind it out every inch of the way.
Here he comes. CJ's making his way down Columbus Drive, about to be the U.S. winner of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon. He's got a smile on his face. He's still looking over his shoulder. You got it, buddy. You don't have to look back.
Nice time. Big time PR for this man. He worked hard. He was on 2:07 pace for a while, but he's going to celebrate and enjoy this. He's going to come through it right about 2:08:15, 2:08:16 unofficially for C.J. Albertson. Big time PR, over a minute, minute and a half.
All right, let's get to Ruth Chepngetich. She has turned onto Mount Roosevelt herself, so she is making her way. Oh my goodness, is she going to do it? Are we going to have another world record at the Bank of America Chicago Marathon? This is amazing to see. She has been in the lead the entire race. She is pounding it out. She looks like she's gained some more strength and is moving even quicker.
She has about 350 meters to go. She went through the half marathon faster than we've ever seen anyone on U.S. soil go through in 64:16, roughly. She's been able to hammer each and every step of the way, and this is something that she's been dreaming about, getting out up this hill, making a turn. She ran her last mile in 4:48. This is something that we will never see here in this year.
Wait a minute.
I'm just so excited by it.
Here we go.
We saw 2:00 on the men's side. This year, are we going to see a sub 2:10?
All right, caller, bring her in. You got it, Carrie. Here is going to be our champion, Ruth Chepin-Gedich. What a beautiful run to have watched. This race for her, it's like she's like, I had a plan, and this is it.
Well, she is a mom. She foregoed going being a cop. She is now going to break the tape of the 2024 Bank of America Chicago Marathon in a time of 2. Can I see it? Are we going to see it? Are we going to see it? 2:09 something. Let's get her here, everybody. We have seen it. Bring it on, Neil Armstrong. We have another woman that has done something just like you. This is amazing right here. Sub 2:10, everybody. That woman has worked so hard. She's done things in this sport that we have not seen. She did it again today.
Unbelievable. Another world record at the Bank of America Chicago Marathon. Do we have an unofficial time? You were clocking, weren't you, Ed? What did you see?
I have 2:09:56 on my old coach's stopwatch. I believe that is also, I'm getting nods, that may be our official time, but the big deal, sub 2:10 for the first time in history, folks. Just happy and a privilege to be a part of this.
I mean, again, look at that flag, and we saw that last year. And this whole year, I know people have been thinking about what Kenyan athletes can do, and we've seen it. And she has been one of those Kenyan athletes that even the men look up to. She's won this race now 3 times. Not once, but 3 times, and she was second last year. Last year at that record.
Beautiful. The course record was set last year by Safwan Hassan at 2:13:44. It has now been smashed by our new world record marathon runner, Ruth Chepin-Gedich. 2:09:57 unofficially. Amazing. Another world record. Kerry Pinkowski knows what he's doing, doesn't he?
He sure does, and she knows what she's doing. She went out hard. I was a little bit nervous again. She went hard in 64:16, I believe, and then came back and crushed that 2:10 mark. Wow, composure, confidence, focus, drive, determination, love of this sport. It is a hard one. You have to give it everything, and especially with a woman who trains on her own. She's got a daughter back home who's looking up to her. I mean, all of us women are looking up to her. This is something that none of us thought was going to happen.
Amazing work.
And fearless.
Amazing to
fearless
see.
On her part to go out where no one has gone before, to be on the fastest half marathon ever run on U.S. soil with another half to run. But she was not, she was undaunted. She was pushed full speed ahead, and for her to finish like she did, breaking 2:10 for the first time, history has been made.
And she looks great.
She looked great the whole time.
She was chomping at the bit. She was chomping at the footsteps of her pacers. She wanted to go even faster, and look at her here.
She looks like she has something in the tank.
Smiling, happy. Oh. This
Amazing.
Might be her new American home, Chicago.
Hey, why not? We'll have her, you know? We'll take her. She's the champion, and she deserves to be here as often as she likes. So great to see. Oh, what a beautiful race. Top to bottom. Top to bottom.
You know, never once really looked around to see who was with her. There might have been a glance, but it was all eyes up front, really looking to see what she could do and watch that clock.
Yeah, something to see. Top men, it looks like John Carrere, 2:02:43, Issa, 2:04:39, Capruto, 2:04:50, Gedich, 2:05:15, and Abeno, 2:06. I can't see the 04. Thank you, Jay Holder, for bringing us those times. There's Kerry Pinkowski kissing the cheeks of his champion. You know he is so thrilled. And we knew the women's race was going to be one to watch this year, didn't we? We've been talking a little bit about that this was the one that was sort of, the possibility was there. there. She was always at the top of the list of the folks you were talking about, and she sure has shown and proved. There's no doubt about that.
And as we were excited, we were thinking, yeah, sub 213, sub 212, but to go sub 210, it's just mind-boggling.
It is. And, you know, she was ninth in London this spring. So
wow.
She didn't quite have her day there. And she just, even her tune-up was 65.58 for the half marathon race that she used for her tune-up. She went through almost 2 minutes faster in her half in this race.
It's almost like she had a plan. Like she meant to make, you know, maybe not for the spring marathon, but maybe in her tune-ups, she had a plan.
Yeah,
you know, maybe
she was in training.
Just training it out and seeing where it brought her. Because whatever she did it right.
Well, she was number four all-time coming in. She's number one now.
Number one.
And I believe the number one thing that she did right was to come to Chicago, run on this course. We talked about it before. You got to have all the elements come together. It's a great time of the year. The course is flat. It's fast. When the weather conditions cooperate, it's good. And then you had, I'd like to say she had good competition, but quite frankly, her only competition was the stopwatch and those pacers that were pushing her along early on.
Right. She was in this race by herself most of the time. And being a two-time champion and even second place last time, she knows this course so well.
She really does. And she's run it each, like, kind of even at times, but then she's also gone out really hard and held on for dear life. So she really knows it. But it was fun. I just got a text from Dina, and she said, "What on earth?" You know, even Dina Caster, the great Dina Caster, is watching and just in awe as well.
Oh, I know she is.
She had a great seat.
The second place finisher still hasn't finished. That's how far ahead.
Yep,
she was. Ruth Chepin-Gedich was. All right, she beat all but two American men, by the way, the top two finishing American.
That's going to light a fire.
Yeah, there you go. All right. Now we're going to check in with Alex with our men's champion, John Carrere. Alex.
Marion, thanks. The second fastest.
You can do it. I love to hear that. That's exactly what Ed was talking about. Now let's check in on Susanna Sullivan. She is our American women's lead runner. How's she looking to you, Carrie?
I think she looks good. She looks like she worked herself through that rough patch. But, you know, this woman has been on a tear, and she's actually had a really good summer coming in. But as I said, she had a really big injury last year. It was devastating to have an injury at that time to come into the Olympic trials. A lot of people were thinking she would be the one to actually make the team. She's on 2:21.44 pace. So she's past 40K, so she's getting closer to home. And definitely really exciting to know that she's under that world championship standard as well, which is 2:23.30.
All right, thanks so much on that. All right, let's get back to Alex, who has our world record holding champion, Ruth Chepin-Gedich. Alex.
Here.
In February, her countryman. Now we're going to check in on our leading U.S. woman. She is about to turn the corner onto Columbus Drive. She's at the peak of Mount Roosevelt. Carrie, she's moving along there. She's making her way in.
She looks great. She is in seventh overall right now. She's making that final left-hand turn. First American is always one of those great stats that you can have being here in Chicago. And she's going to hopefully get under that 2:22 mark. But what a day. Her PR coming in, 2:24.
Wow.
So she has got to be super excited about this and inching her way closer and closer to that 2:20 mark.
Absolutely. Proud to see her. And because she's a full-time sixth grade teacher, folks.
She is.
She's supposed to be one of those everyday people out running. No, she is killing it.
And I just love that because she works and she trains and she makes a difference in these younger kids' lives. And look at her come here.
Is she going to do
that? She's going to get up.
She's going to do it.
Yay. Get there.
Ah, she did it.
Yes.
With 4 seconds to spare, I think. Way to go.
Look at that smile.
She's got to be excited.
Been through a lot.
All right, we're going to send it back down to Alex Maragos with the top men's U.S. finisher. Alex?
C.J. Albertson with us. C.J., a wonderful race today. How did it feel to be out on the course?
Chicago River Walk and the racers out there on Wacker Drive. We thank Abbott for this beautiful drone footage. It lives life to the fullest. We'll be right back with more of the 46th running of the Bank of America Chicago Marathon.